With the beginning of school just weeks away for many states, Americans are beginning to weigh in on returning to the classroom in the midst of a pandemic. 62% of Americans say it will be unsafe to reopen schools. Only 31% think it's safe, according to a new Quinnipiac poll. And among parents, the numbers are slightly better, with 57% saying reopening schools is unsafe, 37% saying it's safe.
So someone who you know has very strong opinions, feelings, and thoughts on this whole debate is doctoral student at the University of Georgia and great friend of the show, Army Osei Frimpong, also known as the Funky Academic, and he joins us now via Skype. Great to see you, Army.
Good to see you, Army.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This is a great topic, and it's also very important because if we don't get it right, look, if we don't reopen schools, people are going to start coming for their property taxes, and you know what? They might be justified.
Mm-hmm. Right? All right, so we talk to us a little bit about how you are thinking about this whole debate, Irmy.
All right, so we need to actually have an argument set up for the conversation about, look, if you're not going to reopen schools, I want my enormous property taxes back. And they might be justified, and we have to think about this in terms of, and the word neoliberalism gets thrown around rather often, but it's just the extension of market values over all aspects of society. So what you do here is you kind of vacate the public goods, you privatize it, because make no mistake, expecting all parents to school their kids or use online schooling, which is pretty much homeschooling because it's not like the computer teaches itself or teaches the kid. You're homeschooling and mass demoting all of those parents who now have to stay home and watch their kids, taking them out of the private sector and putting them in their home. You've privatized education. You haven't just moved it into the home. You've moved it out of the public sector. So what we should think about, instead of privatizing education, which is a weird burden to put on all these parents who might not be disposed or trained to teach their kids the ins and outs of everything you need to know in society, we need to think about decentralizing schools. So we fundamentally have a density problem. The pandemic introduces a density problem. And I don't know why people just don't understand it as a density problem. I think it's because we've kind of, I don't know, evacuated our ability to think about political problems as political problems. But we have too many people in a room in an elementary school. So what we need is more people dispersed throughout the city in classrooms and in buildings that only have 10, 12 people, right? So we have all of these storefronts, malls, church rec rooms that could be leased out and turned into schools, because at the elementary school level, you need a teacher, a para assistant, and 10 kids, right? So we need to think about how to keep public schools public and appropriately as a public good and not privatize these goods. And just get rid of the density problem.
Yeah, and Army, lay out what the social cost of privatizing education. Oh, I agree with you. What is the social cost of having essentially privatized schools through allowing online education? Because I think it's highly detrimental, both to children and to society.
Right. Well, we don't know what education's for. A lot of people think, oh, education's just about what I teach my kid. But no, in a self-determining democracy, in order to self-determine yourself, other people need to know things. If I want to determine myself as a basketball player, it's more than just me practicing. I need my opponent to know the rules of basketball, right? If I want to determine myself as a driver, it's more than just me being able to know how to operate my car. I need to know that the other drivers on the road know the rules of driving.
Right.
Right. So in order to participate in any of these institutions, other people need to know things. And look, if these arguments sound familiar, these arguments don't sound familiar to you, or if this is the first time you've heard that public education isn't about what your kid knows, but about what everybody else knows who's surrounding your kid, who's enabling your kids, then you don't have the stuff it takes to homeschool your kid. And you shouldn't, because this is like fundamental basic democracy that we don't teach all the time, but like this is very important to know, that public education as a national good isn't about what every individual knows. It's about what any individual needs other people to know in order to participate, right? So we think of public education as either like a souped up daycare or like a make work program for white women who did very good in school themselves and really care about the children, or job training to be under your future bosses who themselves went to a private school. But really, public education is about understanding what you need to know to participate with other people in an advanced constitutional democracy.
Well, right? And this gets
let me just...
Sure.
Go
ahead. Finish your thought.
Well, I was just thinking you had a young man who's about to be a congressman on about 10 days ago. And I saw the interview, the guy, I think, Cawthorn.
Yes,
it's not
Madison
clear
Cawthorn.
That he knows the difference between public debt and private debt, or sovereign debt and private money. And that worries me as a person who shares an institution. So I have a vested interest in the quality of education that he imbibed in his youth. So
right.
That's like how I'm invested in public education.
Well, and
especially
I mean,
in a time
thing,
where we need massive
one thing
outlets.
That you and I talked about, one of the, I think, the earliest discussions that you and I had was about the difference in the way that the right thinks about education versus the left. So the standard Democratic Party position now, to the extent that there is one, is basically like public education good, right? On the right, and you see this now with people like Betsy DeVos, they have an agenda not just in terms of like we want to undermine public education, but they have an agenda in terms of what they want the content of that education to be as well. Can you speak to that piece a little bit?
Right. I actually think, and I saw this in Chicago, I think Democrats want out of the business of governing regarding education. They just want out of it. The fundraisers aren't particularly nice. They'd rather deal with economic development. They don't have there's not a content. They're just not interested. They would rather just let the market decide. But the conservatives actually know, I think they know that once you evacuate public education, look, once I'm playing basketball with someone who doesn't know the rules of basketball, they can't actually contest anything I say about what the rules of basketball are. Like, if you're an oligarch, you don't want people to be able to contest your power. But in democracy, it's about being able to contest your power. But in order to contest power, you need to know what the rules are. You need to know your access to information. You need to know your access to power and how to like break up monopolies and like contest a cop who's coming at you. So if you could either teach people how to play basketball by teaching them the rules of basketball, or you can teach people how to play basketball by constantly calling fouls anytime they do something wrong. Right? If you go the latter route, then you have a very anxious opponent who doesn't quite know what they're doing, right or wrong, and you have complete control over what the rules and what we ought to do matter. So like there's actually a strategy about power that goes into keeping the people either ignorant or conventional.
Sure.
They're not
so
going to press for progress because they're not going to know how to press for progress.
I don't disagree with this premise, Irony, but I don't think it's a right-wing thing because I see the 1619 Project, which is rife with inaccuracy and its own thing, partnering with the Pulitzer Center and is now being taught in public schools in Buffalo. So to me, the identitarian left understands this just as well as any of the Christian right. So if we're talking here, I think much
it's
more...
It's an anomaly.
Right. Well, I'm not sure it's an anomaly because the way I'm looking at it is that, especially with this white fragility nonsense, Ibrahim Kendi, et cetera, trying to become a curriculum all across the nation, it seems to me that identitarian left and the Christian right both understand this, but economic populists don't. So speak to that a little bit.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So I'm not sure the identitarian left actually understands it. I don't think it's deep enough to understand it. But you're right that the economic populists don't. Like, everyone should know what a union does.
Mm-hmm.
In fourth grade. When did you actually get you come from professor parents and you went to good
right.
schools. Like, when did you get your understanding that the working class really doesn't have power to negotiate with the corporate class? When did you get that understanding?
Yeah, I mean, basically 2016. That's
2016.
Before that.
When should you have understood this?
Right, when I was a child.
Well, and Irony, actually in West Virginia, which is a state obviously with a storied, deep labor history, they're actually banned from teaching that history in the public school system in the state.
Right.
So you have to do it like with your grandpa in the basement. You get the hidden knowledge about how we took down the coal companies and got fair wages and secured ourselves away from black lung. Like, you can't, but that should be taught in school. Like, for example, in Oregon, black people weren't allowed to buy property until 1926, right? I lived a little bit in Oregon, and I asked regular Oregon people, like, why aren't there so many black people here? They're like, I don't know, they didn't just migrate here. But with that kind of deficit in public awareness of history, you're not going to be able to actually come to an understanding about why you need reparations. Like, you're just not going to know. You're not going to know enough to be able to have an informed opinion about how we make black communities whole in the United States and what Oregon owes to Mississippi. right? So this lack of public education ends up being fundamentally anti-worker, or this lack of content in economic rights, and I think racial justice ends up being fundamentally anti-worker and fundamentally anti-black, right? Hmm. So the question is, can this be mitigated through homeschooling? I just don't think so, because we can't expect every parent to understand these issues. That's why we have professionals. The idea that you could deprofessionalize teaching and privatize it, like I said, I think importantly demotes a lot of like working class people, because you know they understand the people at the top 20%. They're gonna have private tutors. They're gonna have someone else go through their kid. They're gonna have boutique schools of stay at home parents or of work at home parents. Like they'll figure this out. But for everybody else, they'll just end up like more prey to the power plays of the top 20%.
Yeah, yeah, I think such an excellent point. Irami, thank you for joining us as always.
Always insightful, Irami. Thank you.
Hey, no problem. Mm-hmm. Take care.
Next on Rising, some shakeups in the Trump campaign as polls continue to show the president behind Joe Biden. Those changes and the polls when Rising continues.